Hi everyone. So we'll continue with selections, and today we'll also learn how to write complex selections. And as part of the lab today, I will show you how to basically write if statements and write more complex problems with selections. I will probably also go over a few of the problems in labs 5 and 6 if we have time to basically write a couple of interesting questions. That's basically what we want to do today. Any questions before we start? Okay. If not, let's continue from last time. So basically last time we talked about if statements, and we also talked about comparisons of numbers in Java, and we'll continue now with more complex problems. And the first kind of problem that I want to discuss is computing taxes. Now, before the federal income tax code was changed, basically, in order to file for at the end of the year for income tax, you basically had to compute a certain area. So it was based on multiple conditions. It was based on the tax rate, the amount that you would basically make, or also based on if you file single, married, married separated, or head of household with children and so on. So really, in order to find what tax rate you would use, you basically had to, and this is also the case, in fact, today, you had to compute the amount that the household earns, and then under what filing. If you file for a single dependent, that single, or jointly with a spouse or a partner. If you file with as a head of household with children and so on. So there are different statuses and different amounts. And based on that, you would basically decide what tax rate is going to be charged. But before we learn how to do that, let's talk about logical operators. Now, everybody in this class took some logic class. Most of you took CSE 150, discrete math, or foundations of computer science for honor students. And basically some of the operators that you learned were negation, conjunction, disjunction, exclusive OR. They are also available in programming languages. So for instance, in Java, negation is symbolized by the exclamation sign. It's like an inverse operator. If the condition is true, the negation of that condition is false, and vice versa. If the condition is false, the negation of it is true. The conjunction is with these two ampersand signs, basically with and signs. There are actually two different and signs in Java. There are the unconditional conjunction, which is a single and sign, and the conditional conjunction. One thing that you probably know about conjunction is that both operands must be true in order for the conjunction to be true. If the first one is false, then there is no reason to evaluate the second one. So that is what is implemented by this double and sign. However, sometimes we have side effects in the operators, like for instance, the pre-increment or post-increment operators, or pre-decrement, post-decrement operator. So it's not always the case that if the first operand is false, you would also want to execute the second operand. You would not want to execute the second operand. So there are two conjunction operators in Java. There is the double one that we will talk about today, also called the shortcut operator or conditional operator. And there is the one with a single and sign, which is called the unconditional operator, basically meaning that both operands will be executed no matter what the first operand is, true or false. Similarly for disjunction, the double vertical bar is for conditional disjunction. So if the first operand is true, then the second one is not executed because disjunction is true if either one of the operands is true. Similarly, if you use a single vertical bar, then it basically, it's the unconditional disjunction, which basically means that both operands will be executed no matter what. There is a question in the chat. Is that bitwise AND? It's also used for bitwise AND. I will explain to you later when does it work as a bitwise AND versus just basically conjunction. We have actually today later the bitwise operators, if we get into the mathematical operations in the next set of slides.
Professor?
Yeah.
I just have a question about the single AND. Is there a time, you know, wouldn't that kind of mess with the readability of the code? And, you know, it just, under what conditions would you really use it?
So one thing that you have to take into consideration is that usually you write code in a group. So you can't control your collaborators. Your collaborators may actually use that that unconditional conjunction. So it's not always the case. So yes, I agree with you. That is probably not a good programming practice to have side effects. In fact, it's kind of like a style not to have side effects. So I personally will agree with you that you shouldn't put in the second operand an increment, because that's not good style. But you should know if somebody else writes the code, writes code that you are going to use, how does it behave? And in order to make sure that it always increments a value, you should basically know both operands and know the difference between them.
Thank you.
Welcome. And similarly for disjunction. Exclusive OR, it's true if one is true and the other one is false. One operand is true and the other one is false. It's the negation of equivalence. So it's not the case they both have the same true value. So let's go over examples of each one of them. So first of all, we have on the left-hand side the truth table for negation and in the future for the rest of the operators. So when a Boolean expression P is true, its negation is false. And when the Boolean expression is false, its negation is true. So now assume that we have two variables, age, that is 24, and gender, that is a character, uppercase F. The negation of age greater than 18 is the negation of 24 greater than 18, which is true. The negation of true is false. Again, because the age 24 is greater than 18. Similarly, the negation of gender is different than F. Since the gender is F, F different than F is false, and the negation of false is true. So always the negation is an inverse operator. True becomes false and false becomes true. The negation of true is false, the negation of false is true. Next operator is conjunction. So again, remember actually that not all of the operations are actually executed. In fact, more correct would be if I delete these two cases. Because if P1 is false, no matter what P2 is, the conjunction is false and P2 is never executed in this conditional operator. So first of all, let's draw the truth table for conjunction. We have P1 and P2 and all possible cases. Both of them are false. P1 is false, P2 is true. P1 is true, P2 is false. And P1 and P2 are both true. Conjunction is true if and only if both operands are true. So basically, it's false in all cases except the last tuple, last row, in which both P1 and P2 are true. So now again, we go to the example. So we have the age 24 and the gender F. And now we have two conjunctions. The first conjunction is the age is greater than 18 and the gender is F, which is a true conjunction because both 24 is greater than 18 is true. And the gender is equal with the uppercase F character is also true. So basically both operands are true, the conjunction is true. In the second example, the age is greater than 18 and the gender is different than F is false because although the first argument, the first operand is true, the 24 is greater than 18, the gender different than F is false and true and false is false. So again, we basically consider the case that even if P1 is true, P2 is still false. Now, this is a shortcut operator. So one thing that I can show you is that the second operand is never even executed. So consider that we have an integer I is equal with 0, and we have a Boolean condition. Now, it's not always necessary that you put it in an if statement. You can actually execute it something like this. So you have here false, and I is incremented with 1. Now, 1 may actually want this to be executed. You can put it in an if statement. So you can actually try to write an if statement. So let's say that we want to print system.out.println inside the if statement. Okay. Now, I++, let's say that is I++ is greater than 0, greater than equal with 0. It doesn't really matter if this is true or false, because this second part is never executed. So now let's print the value of I, and it will print 0, because I was never incremented to anything. The second part was never executed. Since the first part is false, the second one is not executed. If you delete one of the end signs, then you can see that even if this was false and inside if was never printed, still both operands were executed. And of course, one of the operands had a side effect. I was incremented with 1 after that step. So when we print I, is now 1. It's basically incremented from 0 to 1. That's the difference between those two operators. So the double 1, the double and sign, is basically a shortcut operator. If the first operand is false, then the second one is never executed, because a conjunction is true if and only if both operands are true. Any questions? Disjunction. So disjunction works as follows. If one of the operands is true, then the result of the disjunction is true, no matter what the second operand is. So again, we have the truth table with all the possible situations. P1 is false, P2 is false, the disjunction is false. P1 is false, P2 is true, the disjunction is true, because one of them is true. P1 is true, doesn't matter what P2 is, the disjunction is true. And in fact, that's exactly how this double vertical bar, this disjunction operator works. If one of the operands is true, the first operand is true, the second operand is not even executed. Again, because it's a shortcut operator. So again, let's start with this example. So age is 24, gender is F. If age is greater than 34, which is false because 24 is not greater than 34, or the gender is F, the gender is F is true. Therefore, the entire disjunction, even if the first operand was false, the entire disjunction is true. In the second case, the age is greater than 34 or the gender is equal with M, it's false because both of the two operands of that disjunction are false. So 24 greater than 34 is false. F is equal with M is false. So both of them are false. In that case, basically the entire disjunction is false. Now let me show you the shortcut operator in this case. So in the case of disjunction, you start with true. So in this case, you can see that the disjunction is true no matter what the second operand does, because the first operand is true. So again, what happens, this is the shortcut operator with two vertical bars. The result of the disjunction is that I is never incremented. In fact, in this case, you can actually see that it went inside the if statement because the disjunction was true. However, this was never executed, the increment of I with one. Now, we delete one of those vertical bars. Now, this becomes an unconditional disjunction. It means that even if the first operand is true, the second one is still executed because that's what unconditional disjunction means. Both operands will be executed. So in this case, again, it's true. It will print inside if, but in addition to that, it also increments I to one because the second operand is executed. It can even be false. It doesn't matter. So I can basically say if this is greater than 100, 1000. So even if that second operand is false because one, actually zero, because this is a post increment, is not greater than 1000, still when you execute it, it's still incremented with one. So even false conditions are executed no matter what, because this basically says execute both operands, no matter if they are true or false, as long as basically the entire disjunction is true, you have the increment. Even if this is false, so in fact, the if statement will never execute the inner print statement, it still increments I to one. Because even if the entire condition is false, it still executes both sides and has side effects, more importantly. Yes. So again, we have a question about bitwise operators. I will actually tell you about bitwise operators in the next part of the lecture, in case that we get to that today. So I have a couple of examples of bitwise operations in the slides on mathematical functions, characters, and strings. But let's continue with selections. Okay, good. The next operator is exclusive OR. So exclusive OR is executed no matter what, because even if you know the value of the first operand, you need the value of the second operand in order to see if they are different or they are the same. So exclusive OR is true if the two values of the two operands are opposite to each other. So you see, if P1 is false and P2 is false, then the exclusive OR is false. Similarly, if P1 is true and P2 is true, then the exclusive OR is false. Again, they are the same. That's not the case for exclusive OR. The cases in which P1 XOR P2 is true are the two cases when P1 is false and P2 is true, and P1 is true and P2 is false. So basically, you need to execute both operands no matter what. Given only one operand, you cannot infer the truth of the exclusive OR. So again, we have the same starting example. The age is 24, the gender is F, and now we have an exclusive OR between the age is greater than 34 and the gender is equal with F is true, because age greater than 34 is false and gender is F is true. So basically the two operands of that exclusive OR are of opposite values. In the second example, the age is greater than 34 or the gender is M. It's false because both 24 greater than 34 is false and F is equal with M is false. So this is one of the cases in which is false because both of the operands are false. Another one would be in the case that both operands are true. Again, the exclusive OR is false, and actually, now that I see, I have a typo in this slide. I'm still using the OR operator, not the exclusive OR operator. I'm sorry about that. I will update always the slides when I see this kind of cases during the lecture. There is a question. If exclusive OR and different are equivalent. That's exactly true. Basically, you can use the not equal sign for Boolean values. So you can compare the two Boolean values. Are these two Boolean values the same or different? One is true and the other one is false. So you are totally right. Exclusive OR is actually the same in this case with negation equal, basically not equal. Very good point. Okay, so here I have a bunch of examples of logical operators. So result is a Boolean variable. Result is equal with 5 is less than equal with 9 is true. Result is equal with not 5 is less than equal with 9 is false, because 5 less than equal with 9 is true, and the negation of that is false. Result is equal with 3.9 is greater than 3.19 is of course true, because 3.9 is bigger real number than 3.19. Result is equal with the lower character A equal with the upper character A is false. Java is case sensitive, including for characters. Those two have different Unicode codes. Lowercase A is 97, uppercase A is 65. Result is equal with 5 is less than equal with 9, and 8 is clearly greater than 9. It's false. Although the first operand is true, the second one is false. 8 is not greater than 9, and this is conjunction. The result is equal with 5 less than equal with 9, or doesn't matter or what, it's already true because the first operand is already true. 5 is less than equal with 9. And more complex examples. For instance, we want to check if a number is divisible both by 2 and 3. So we usually do divisibility by dividing with that number and checking that the remainder after division, number modulo 2, is equal with 0. Then we know that there is no remainder after the division, therefore the number is divisible by that divider. So basically, the first condition is the conjunction between the number modulo 2 is equal with 0 and the number modulo 3 is equal with 0. The second condition is the number divisible by 2 or 3 is written as is the number modulo 2 equal with 0 or the number modulo 3 is equal with 0. Finally, is the number divisible by 2 or 3 but not both is exclusive OR? Because we've write it as number modulo 2 is equal with 0, exclusive OR or XOR, the number modulo 3 is equal with 0. This expression is only true if one of them divides the number and the other one doesn't. One of them must be true, doesn't matter which one, as long as the other one doesn't. Now, a leap year. If you look at the definition of the leap year, a leap year is defined as follows, and you can look in Wikipedia. This is a definition taken exactly from Wikipedia. A year is considered to be a leap year if it's divisible by 4, but not by 100, or it is divisible by 400. So basically, the time that it takes the Earth to go around the sun, it's 365 days. But not exactly 365 days. It's basically 365 days and a couple of hours. So what basically happens is that every year, you basically get another quarter of a day extra. So every 4 years, we add another one day, 366 days, okay? Or 364 and 365. I don't know exactly the number of days in 1 year, but I believe that is around that number. So the rule is that every 4 years, we have an extra day, and that's the leap year. And those years are the years that are divisible by 4, but not by 100, because every 100 days, we actually have to do another correction. So it's not exactly that one quarter of the day of a day is actually gained by the Earth around the sun. So every 100 years, the leap year is actually dropped. So for instance, year 2000 was not a leap year, because although it's divisible by 4, it was a leap year for the other reason. So the year 1900 was not a leap year, because it's divisible by 4, but not by one, but is also divisible by 100. However, is not divisible by 400. So there is another correction to the correction that every 100 years, the year is not considered to be a leap year. And that correction is that every 400 years, the year is considered to be a leap year. Okay. So let's assume that we have an integer variable year, and we want to detect if the year is a leap year. So for instance, the condition, the complex condition to check if the year is a leap year is that the year modulo 4 is equal with 0, that the year is divisible by 4, and the year is not divisible by 100, so year modulo 100 is not equal with 0, or the year is divisible by 400. So let's see a couple of examples. Again, I'm going to define an integer variable. Let's say year, and let's use the scanner to read a couple of years. So scanner input is equal with scanner system.input. And the year is something that the user enters. Next integer. And we want to print the result of that condition. So let's actually write a Boolean. Leap is equal with, and here we have two possibilities. The first one is that the year modulo 4 is equal with 0, but not the year modulo 4 modulo 100 is different than 0. And the second condition is that the year modulo 400 is equal with 0. So that's the condition for leap year. And now we can basically print out the result of leap year. Leap, concatenated with leap. Okay. So let's run it. So the user, we are asking if year, let's say 1900 was a leap year and it was not. And if we want to see if year 2000 was a leap year, it was true because of the second condition. Let's see if 2020 was a leap year, it was true because it's divisible by 4 and not divisible by 100. Let's see if year 2021 is a leap year and it's not, because it's not divisible by 4, so the conjunction here is false, and is not divisible by 400, so both operands of the disjunction are false. Okay, any questions? Okay. So now the unconditional conjunction and disjunction. So they work identical or not quite identical, exactly with the same result as the double and double or operators, with the exception that they always evaluate both operands, no matter what. So there are basically cases when they differ, and they don't differ in the difference in the value of the expression. They differ in what happens with side effects. So for instance, here is that example that I showed before. If x is 1, then x strictly greater than 1 is false. And if you plug it in both conditional and unconditional operators, in the conditional operator, it stops after conjunction because it already knows that this is false. In the unconditional conjunction, it evaluates both. So implicitly, it increments x with 1, and x becomes 2. After this condition, although the condition is false. Similarly for disjunction, if x was 1, 1 equal with x is true in both cases. In the first case, it makes the entire disjunction true, so the second part is never executed. It doesn't matter if it's true or false. In the second case, it executes the second part no matter what. So again, it doesn't matter if it's true or if it would be false, it has the side effect in X. In either case, the disjunction is true because the first operand was already true. Okay. Any questions? Next type of operators in Java are the switch case operators. So switch case applies for a limited set of types, those types that are either primitive values or they are strings. You can't apply the switch operator on any type because basically you are looking for types that can be compared, in particular for equality. And you also are trying actually to do a single comparison, okay? So equality can be distributed for a single comparison. And next semester, for those of you that are going to take CSC 260, we'll talk about hash maps. So a hash map is a way to reduce one value to a subset of values. Basically, you have a finite number of values possible for a variable. You can basically apply the hash function to that variable or to that expression, and you get a finite set of values. This helps you to directly actually have a go-to statement to the case that you actually want to execute. So switch is always equality. You take an expression, you evaluate it, and then you directly jump to the value that that expression evaluates to. So if that expression is zero, you jump to the statements following case zero and you execute them. You execute them until the end of the block or the break that basically it's inside that block that breaks the block. So this break statement is actually a statement in Java that finishes the current block. So in order to stop after each case, you need a special type of statement called break. So if the variable is one, you execute some code and then you jump to the end of the switch case statement. If the variable or value is two, you execute code and then jump to the end of the switch case statement and so on. If these breaks didn't exist, the execution will just continue. So the way that internally a switch case is implemented is that you have all of these statements in a block somewhere in memory. And then you do the comparison of the variable or the expression with the values that are possible for that expression plus a default case. And the moment that you find that that variable matches one of the first one of those statements, it jumps at that location and starts executing the rest of the code in that block. So if these breaks wouldn't be here, it would jump to whatever value that variable has, and then it just continues with the rest of the statements. So it's really a way to do one comparison, one equality comparison, and then jump to the line corresponding to that equality comparison. So the way that you can see the flowchart for that switch statement that we had before is that if the variable is zero, you execute some statements, and then you continue to a break and go to the end of the switch statement. If there is no break, then you basically just continue to the next statement, the next possible statement for a different value of the variable. But usually the way that we execute these switch case statements are with breaks. You want to execute some code if the user entered the, let's say, the letter A, some code if the user entered the letter B, and so on. So usually switch case statements are used for menus. Menus when you are given, choose one of these alternatives and you want to execute one of the alternatives, not one followed by the rest of the alternatives. Now, there is only a subset of types that is accepted in switch case statements. Character, byte, short, int, because they basically can be represented on at most 4 bytes in the case of int. And there are hash functions that directly take you from any value in this set and can map to one specific value, the hash value of that set. So you can have one comparison between the expression and all of these values, and the first one that matches will be followed. Another type that was added in Java 1.5, that's usually the case that you need a switch statement, are strings. Really, the reason was that it's so common that you want to compare a string with several possible values, and you want to jump to that location. Internally, what happens is that basically it computes for that expression a hash value, and computes a hash value for every one of the possible values, the possible v1, value 1 to value n. Those are constant expressions, and we can basically get the true value of the comparison in with just one comparison. Okay. Again, you would need break statements, because otherwise it will just continue in all of the statements following the current case. So these breaks are optional. Optional in the case that basically you as a programmer do not may choose not to add them. But if you don't put them, then the switch statement just continues to the next possible case. So it doesn't terminate the current case. It just continues to the next one. Default is optional. Default is the case when the switch expression evaluated to a value that is neither one of the values that we enumerated from value 1 to value n. And those statements will be executed in case that none of those was true. Again, a break statement is necessary to the value before the default case. Otherwise, for that value, it will just continue with the default case. Again, the way that this is actually implemented is that this entire block of statements is stored somewhere else in memory. You do a comparison, and then you jump directly to that block and start executing the statements. Okay. If you wouldn't have break statements, then you basically will just continue executing the rest of the statements in other cases. So yeah, let me show you an example. So in this example, suppose that the character is lowercase a, and we compare with the lowercase a, b, and c. Because it's lowercase a, it starts executing the statement, the printout statements. And because we don't have any break, it just continues. And in the end, it will print three lowercase a's. If the character was lowercase b, then it will start from this point, the second print statement, and will print two b's. If the character was c, it would print only one c. So quite unexpected behavior. If a, three a's, if b, two b's, if c, just one c. Now, the opposite code is with breaks. So again, if suppose that the character was lowercase a, we have the case for a, we print out one a, we break, and we jump out. So it doesn't matter if it was A or B or C, it prints the character only once, A or B or C. And we don't need a break after the case number C because there is nothing else, no other cases or default statements. So that's why we basically don't need a break here. You can put it, but it's really just as an insurance that if somebody puts more cases later, they may forget to put a break for them. Any questions about the switch case statement and the two basically ideas about breaks that you need to put them between the cases? There's one question in the chat. Can you explain the character? Yeah. So let's actually do an example. We have a scanner. So again, let's say that we want to read one character. In Java, there is no function to read one character. So what we usually do, we use the input to read one line or one string. I sometimes don't like the auto completion. And from that one string, we take the character at index 0. So this basically, this would give us a string. And if we want from that string the first character, then we can basically get from that string with a function that again we will discuss in the next part of the lecture, how to get one character out of a string. So now switch. So ch is a character. And now we have cases. Case if the character is lowercase a, then let me actually start here. System.out.println the character followed by a break. If I don't put a break, then it basically goes to the next case. Okay. Now we have similar for case B, case C, and let's say default. So in the case of default, again, we want the character to be printed once. Okay. So now let's enter A, and of course it prints A, 1A. If this break wouldn't have been here, it will print 4A's because it starts here and just continues with all of the other print statements. So we run this. A will print 4 A's. In case of B, it will print 3 B's because it starts here and prints 3 times B. So the same example, but with B prints 3 B's, the same example with C prints 2 C's, the same example with D, a letter that is not one of the cases, it prints only the last statement. So really these break statements are necessary if we want only what's within that case to be executed. Now, one thing that is quite regular is to actually combine multiple cases into one. So let's say that I want both for uppercase A and lowercase A to print the character, okay? So what happens in this case is that, yes, it starts right here for uppercase A, but since there is no break or no statement, it just goes and executes the next part, the next case. So we can do this. We can say there is the case for A's, there is the case for B's, and there is the case for C's. So this is customary. Basically, it is quite often the case that you would get something like this, that only for one case, it has the print statement, but it considers actually 2 possible cases. So what happens if we enter A? It prints 1A. What happens if we enter uppercase A? It prints the character, so it prints uppercase A. Okay, there were a bunch of questions. So let's start from the, which statement do you print? Okay, can you accomplish the same with if statements? Yes, but you would have a comparison for each. So if I would have written this same case, but with if statements, you would probably have written something of this kind. If character is equal with lowercase a, or character is equal with uppercase a, then print the character. Then similarly for B's, if the character is equal with lowercase b and uppercase b, then print the character and so on. But usually, I mean, this is much easier if somebody wants to print a menu. And it's quite common the case that you ask the user, enter A if you want to execute this method, enter B if you want to execute this other method and so on, a switch case statement fits perfectly. You would basically have a menu, A corresponds to this, B corresponds to this, and the user will have to enter the correct input. So let's say that I want to write a program like that. So we print the menu, system.out.println. One is convert Fahrenheit to to Celsius and B is convert Celsius to Fahrenheit. And now we are asking the user choose between 1 and 2. Input 1 or 2. Okay. So now we basically wait for the user to enter an input. And the user will enter a character, a string, and we read the character. And now if it's 1, we basically do 1 conversion. So we basically convert from Fahrenheit to Celsius. If it's 2, we do a different conversion. Okay. We don't print the character. We actually are going to do the conversion. So maybe we'll also read some temperature. So after we read the character, we ask the user, okay, enter the temperature in that. Even maybe we can put it here. So if it's 1, we say enter the Fahrenheit. And if it's 2, we tell them enter the Celsius temperature. Okay. So this is a case where you print a menu and then the user chooses one of the options. With switch statements, you write less characters. That's totally right. Would input.next do the same? Yes, you are right. One thing that I observed is that sometimes input.next, so one thing about input.next, if you have other characters that follow it, they will be actually part of the next input. So that's the problem that I don't like about next instead of next line. What if the user writes some more stuff? Okay. So what if the user says 1 and then we write something else and blah, blah. Okay. Now, when we are asking for the next input, actually it will read the blah, blah. Okay, so that's the part that I don't like about next instead of next line. So let's say that we had the previous code. Okay, let me take this out, maybe also the break because we have only 2 cases. And now we basically read a string. We ask the user system dot, actually just read the string for the temperature. So string temperature is equal with input.next, next after the next. So now if we run it and we say 1, blah, blah, actually the temperature that it was read in temp is blah, blah. So that's why I don't like input.next used in such a context, in a context where you read a line, you do something based on what line you read. Because in fact, you have still input in the pipeline. Okay. So actually, let me show you that that was the case. System.out.println temperature. The temperature that it read, 1, blah, blah. The temperature that was read was blah, blah. So that's personally, I would use print line, next line. And now 1 followed by blah, blah, we'll ignore blah, blah, and we'll actually wait for the temperature, like whatever is the temperature in Fahrenheit 70. So that's why I like next line. It reads the entire line and discards garbage that was entered. Okay. Switch statements also have the opportunity to be faster because it only does 1 comparison with all of these values at once. You can read the character in uppercase, or you can actually even convert it with character dot to uppercase of ch. So you don't need case for lowercase and case for uppercase. You don't need what we had before. And then another case for uppercase. It's again one of the functions that we will learn if we get to mathematical functions and characters. Next question. Next is the same with next line, with the exception that next will read up to the first white space, while next line will read up to the end of the line, everything up to the end of the line. So again, if we use, maybe I will just read the entire string. Let me actually do that. So let's say that I'm reading one string and you will see the difference. So in the first case, let's say that we write, I teach CS. Next, we'll only read the characters up to the first white space. Next line, I teach CS, we'll read the entire line up to the end of the line. Okay. Do you need dot character at index 0 since the next line takes the entire string? So again, the problem here is, let's say that I wanted for 1 do this and for 2 do something else. If the user writes something after with comparing the entire string, it will basically not work because the user may actually write some garbage. Okay, so that's why I'm not going to implement that, but that's why I would do the character at index 0 to extract only one character, the first character in the string. Switch can accept strings. That's completely true. So let's actually do string s, and then if s is 1, do that. If s is 2, do that other thing. So you can see that string is switched. Since Java 1.5 or Java 5, it accepts strings. But in that case, you can't put any kind of garbage afterwards, because then it will not be in either one of the two cases. So the same program, if I try to run it and I enter 1, blah, it will basically just keep the switch statement, because it's neither a case that is 1 nor that is 2. It's 1 blah. Okay, excellent. Next, Boolean conditional operators. So in many cases, you want to write more compact code. And you want to assign, this is always probably the case, that based on a value, on a Boolean condition, you want to assign to one variable a value or another value. So an if statement like this one, if x is greater than 0, y is equal with 1, else y is equal with minus 1. It's basically the sign of the value. If it's strictly positive, y will be 1. If it's not strictly positive, it's minus 1. Is equivalent with a conditional operator. A conditional operator is a Boolean expression followed by the question mark sign, followed with another expression, followed by the colon, followed by another expression. And it's executed as follows. If the Boolean expression is true, then the value of the conditional operator is the value of expression 1. If the Boolean expression is false, then the value of the conditional expression is the value of expression 2. So basically, it's like writing an if statement, but inside an expression that is evaluated either to the first value or the second value. As opposed to if statements, you can't have only the if part. You can't basically just say if x is greater than 0, question mark 1. No, you can't do that, because this always has to be evaluated to a value. So you can't have only one part if statement. You have to have both part if statements. If this expression is true, then one value, else another value. It can be used in different cases. It can be used as an as in part of an assignment, or it can be used in a print statement. For instance, in this case, where based on the condition you print a concatenation of the number and is even versus a concatenation with the number and is odd. So it basically chooses what to print as the result of the conditional statement. Okay. So this is quite often used. That's why it's very important for you to understand question mark colon as is actually a conditional operator with three operands: the condition, the value of the expression for the condition true, and the value of the expression for the condition false. Okay. I personally use it quite a lot. So you probably will also start using it quite a lot as you start becoming programmers. Okay, now operators are always executed with respect to this order precedence. So post increment, post decrement, then we have plus and unary minus, they are the highest precedence operators. Then pre-increment, pre-decrement, typecasting is higher priority than many operators. Negation has higher priority than conjunction, division, multiplication, multiplication, division, modulo operator or remainder. Those have higher priority than plus and minus, like in arithmetics, you are used to PEMDAS. Less than equal are lower priority than than arithmetical operations. So that's why first operands are evaluated and then they are compared. Those operators have higher precedence than equality and inequality, which have higher precedence than exclusive OR, which has higher precedence than conjunction, shortcut operator, which has higher precedence than disjunction. This is again in logic, we have conjunction is higher precedence than disjunction. Because this can be inside Boolean expressions, they have higher precedence than assignment operators, because you basically have to compute a Boolean expression before you assign it to a variable. And all binary operators except assignment operators are left associative. So left associativity means the following. Let me actually show you an example. So what is left associativity? When you execute an operation, let's say 10 divided by 2, 5 divided by 2, okay? In what order do you execute it? From the left-hand side or from the right-hand side? So in this case, it's basically executed from the left-hand side. It's 5 divided by 10 divided by 5, everything divided by 2. It's not the case that first we divide, because these are giving you different values. If you divide 10 by the result of 5 divided by 2, the result in this case is 10 divided by the quotient of the division of 5 with 2, which is 5. And this one is 2 divided by 2, which is equal with 1. All operators except assignment are basically left associative. So we have an implicit grouping of operators that have equal precedence to the left. So you start 10 divided by 5, the result divided by 2. However, assignment is different. If you have I plus equal J plus equal K plus equal, let's say, 2, okay? And you may have had before some integer definition. So I, let's say, I is assigned 1, J is assigned 2, K is assigned 3. So what happens in this case? Basically, assignment are right associative. So basically K is incremented with 2, then J is incremented with the value that you incremented K with, and I is incremented with the value of J. So as a basically result, first of all, it will execute the assignment to the right-hand side. So K is incremented with 2, so K is 5. Then j is incremented. J is 2 plus 5, which is 7. And I is j plus, or the old value of I, which was 1, plus the new value of j, which is 7, which is equal with 8. So assignments are basically grouped to the right-hand side. Okay? They are called right associative. As opposed to all of the other operations, which are left associative. Meaning that they are grouped to the left-hand side. Equal operators are grouped to the left-hand side. Okay? So that's basically the fact that all binary operators are left associative with the exception of assignment operators. Because assignment operators, they have to assign something to the right-hand side before you can assign to the left-hand side operands. So here is an example. We have 3 plus 4 multiply with 4 greater than 5 multiply with 4 plus 3 minus 1. First, parenthesized expressions are evaluated, like in PEMDAS. We have 4 plus 3 is 7. Then 4 multiply with 4, so equal operators are executed from the left-hand side to the right-hand side. So 4 by 4 is 16. 5 by 7 is 35. Then 3 plus 16 is 19. 35 minus 1 is 34. And 19 greater than 34 is false. So basically, they are executed in that order of operations. Associativity, as I explained it again, is that all operators are left associative with the exception of assignment. So when you have something like this, A equal B plus equals C equal with 5, C is assigned 5, then B is incremented with 5, and A is assigned a new value of B. Unary minus operator, so when you have minus a number, so minus 5. There is also positive unary operator, so plus 5. It's a number, it's equal with 5. So that's unary operators, minus and plus. Okay. So now, last time we actually implemented a larger program. If you want to change maker also to consider that no negative numbers are allowed, you can basically do that. You can do all kinds of operations. Like for instance, in the original change maker, if the original amount is less than 1 or greater than 99, then we say out of range and we don't compute anything. Else, we compute the number of quarters, dimes, nickels, and pennies. You can also have nested ifs. So another way to actually extend the example is with a double if statement. If the number of quarters is different than 0, then you want to print that there are quarters. So number of quarters concatenated with quarter. However, you don't want to put the S unless the number of quarters is greater than 1. So if it's equal with 1, then nothing is executed, or a print line statement is executed. Otherwise, it prints an S. Again, so the question that I see in the chat, is there anywhere that you would use a unary plus for? I don't see the reason again, but because again, you work with other developers, it may be the case that they do. So you should be able to recognize such cases. Good. Any questions? If not, let me actually stop the recording.